relationship. Hello, it is 6 a.m. in Washington, midday in Jerusalem. I'm Onita Rajpal. You're watching CNN, the world's news leader. This is World One, live from London. An alleged terror plot, U.S. fingers pointing to Iran, and a growing chorus of condemnation. That's what we're hearing. Here's what we know. The U.S. says Tehran plotted to kill a Saudi envoy on American soil. The FBI says it sounds like a Hollywood script describing a murder-for-hire scheme to assassinate Saudi Arabia's ambassador to the U.S. One suspect, a naturalized U.S. citizen with both Iranian and American passports, is in police custody. We have live team coverage for you from the U.S. to the Middle East with Reza Sayeh in Islamabad and Barbara Starr at the Pentagon. Let's begin with you, Barbara. We want to get a little bit more on this in terms of what kind of actual evidence has the U.S. given and actually released to journalists that Iran, that the government of Iran, is actually involved in this?
Well, in this unsealed complaint that was released yesterday here in the United States, Manita, there were extensive details about the alleged conspiracy, the payments, the meetings, the discussions, the plotting that the U.S. government says went on here.
But then I guess have to assume that there has to be absolute ironclad concrete proof that Iran is involved in order for the U.S. to even begin contemplating military options against it, no?
Well, let me take that in reverse order. Now, contemplating military operations against Iran, there's no indication at the moment that the United States is doing that.
Okay. Barbara, thank you for that. Barbara Starr reporting to us there from the Pentagon. Well, the U.S. claims Iran's murder-for-hire plot involved paying Mexican gangsters to do the actual killing. Tom Keene, the former head of America's 9/11 Commission, told CNN's Aaron Burnett he's scratching his head over what he's hearing about Iran.
It just seems so strange. I mean, they're known as professionals in the intelligence world. We don't like what they do, but they're known as professionals. And the idea...
Well, and neither does Iran. It's incandescent with anger. Iran's permanent representative to the UN told CNN he's shocked to hear such a big lie. CNN's Reza Sayeh is monitoring Iran's reaction from Pakistan's capital. We join him live now in Islamabad. I guess, you know, Reza, there's still so many questions surrounding this. We don't see actual proof that Iran may or may not have been involved in all of this. But I guess what would be the motivation for Iran to even do something like this if they were behind it?
You're absolutely right, Monita. These are all allegations that have yet to be proven, a lot of unanswered questions. And until those questions are answered, it's really impossible to conclude what we have here. And the key question is, what would Iran have to gain by what is, by any measure, a drastic and bizarre plot involving a used car salesman, a Mexican drug cartel, a hitman on U.S. soil.
Reza, thank you for that. Reza Sayeh reporting to us there. Well, you're watching World One live from London. An Israeli soldier held captive for 5 years could be on the verge of release. Hamas leader Khalid Mashal says the Palestinian prisoners will be freed in two separate stages. The second group will leave 2 months after the first. We want to get more now from our Jerusalem bureau chief, Kevin Flower. Kevin, tell us a little bit about who the Israelis are giving up. Who are these prisoners that are being held right now?
Well, at this point, we don't actually have the list of names of these prisoners, so we don't know everyone who's going to be on the list, but what we do know is...
This is World One. We are watching two major weather stories right now. A hurricane has made landfall and is lashing Mexico's west coast. And in Thailand, millions of people are bracing for a flood surge that could inundate the capital. Flood walls are being reinforced around Bangkok to try and protect the city from the country's worst flooding. Paula Hancock is in Rangsit in eastern Bangkok, and she joins us now with the latest on that. Paula.
Well, Monita, it's a race against time at the moment here in Bangkok as officials are trying to shore up the defenses against a huge volume of water that will be arriving over the next couple of days.
As Paula Hancock's in Rangsit in eastern Bangkok. Well, Hurricane Joba has slammed into the west coast of Mexico, unleashing torrential rains and 140-kilometer-an-hour winds. The storm has been downgraded to Category 1, but is still expected to cause a dangerous storm surge. Rafael Romo is there. He joins us now live with that. Rafael. But apologize, we seem to have lost communication there with Rafael Roma. Understandably, of course, the weather situation where he is still quite tenuous. We'll try to bring him back if we can at this point. But we want to get the latest in terms of the weather conditions in those developing stories in Mexico and Thailand with Maya Ramos at the World Weather Center in just about 15 minutes. So stay tuned for that. There's a wave of anger spreading across the United States aimed at the country's wealthiest people. It's going on in several cities, but started out as Occupy Wall Street. On Tuesday, protesters there took their frustrations directly to the rich and to the powerful in New York's Upper East Side. Tony Aiello reports. Tony Aiello reporting there. Let's bring you up to date on some of the other stories that we're talking about here on World One. Let's begin with this gentleman right here. Self-proclaimed U.S. superhero wearing a skin-tight black and gold rubber suit was arrested on charges of assault on Monday. The Seattle native says he tried to break up a fight, but his victims say they were just dancing in the street when a costumed superhero jumped up and pepper sprayed them. For the past year, Phoenix Jones, as he's known, has become famous for patrolling the streets of Seattle with a camera crew looking for crime. Maybe it's the fashion crime that they're looking for. Now let's go to our next story. Joe the plumber here, who became famous during the 2008 presidential campaign, is planning to, get this, run for Congress. Samuel Joseph Wurzbacher became a household name when Republican Senator John McCain repeatedly referred to him as Joe the Plumber in his final debate against Obama, using him as a symbol for the American middle class. Thing is, he doesn't have a plumber's license, but he's running for Congress, as we said. And guess who's got the smelliest socks? Yeah, we've got that question for you here on World One. According to a European study, there was actually a study commissioned for this by the company Black Socks. Only 66% of French men change their socks every day, compared to about 80% of German and British men. The French also average only 17 pairs in their drawer, compared to Germans with 25 pairs. Interestingly, it shows that younger people across Europe are those most likely to change socks more than once a day. Good to know. And BlackBerry users are still without key web and texting services. It's the third day of disruption for millions across Europe, the Middle East, Africa, India, and parts of Latin America. The smartphones maker Research in Motion says it's working to clear a data backlog caused by a failure within its own infrastructure. For some people, it may have been a good break, not having to check their emails all the time. You're watching World One live from London. It is shocked by what it describes as lies. The U.S. is accusing Iran of engineering a murder plot against Saudi Arabia's envoy to the U.S. Saudi Arabia says it is grateful to Washington for stepping in. CNN's Mohammed Jamjoon is in the Middle East and monitoring Saudi reaction. He joins us now from our Abu Dhabi studios. Mohammed, has there been reaction from Saudi Arabia?
Manita, so far very little reaction from the Saudis. There was a short statement that was released last night from the Saudi embassy in Washington, D.C., in which they expressed gratitude.
Thank you so much for that. After weeks of bloody street battles, anti-Gaddafi forces say they are ready for the final push into Sirte. The revolutionaries have had earlier said that once it's fallen, they'll declare the country liberated and announce a new government. CNN's Dan Rivers takes us to the front lines.
Well, this is pretty much the front line in Sirte. You can hear.
Right, Dan, thank you very much for that. Dan Rivers reporting to us there from Sirte, the front lines of this ongoing situation there in Libya. We understand, of course, we've been told that once Sirte falls in the hands of the revolutionaries, they say that's when they will declare Libya free and liberated. But of course, according to Dan, he was saying they are seeing little resistance from Gaddafi forces. Just earlier in the week, the revolutionary forces, those that are loyal to the National Transitional Council, are saying that it could just be a matter of days when Libya is free. Well, as Israel and the Palestinians gear up for their prisoner swap, another prisoner release is underway, this one in Myanmar. Aung San Suu Kyi's National League for Democracy Party says 150 political detainees have been freed today. Back, it was a dramatic night in Euro 2012 qualifying. Four teams booked their places in the finals. Pedro Pinto is here with all the details. And unfortunately, you're not a very happy bunny today.
Happy bunny? No, I'm not. I'm pretty grumpy.
A grumpy bunny.
A grumpy bunny, yeah. Portugal didn't do too well. We'll get to that in just a moment. First stop is Paris, where the top two teams in Group D faced off. France only needed a draw to qualify, while Bosnia-Herzegovina saw a big win for the Tigers in the major leagues.
And we should also mention that Stephen, our director, is also not happy.
Because he's Scottish. Yeah, yeah. always going to be tough for them against Spain.
Oh.
No, against Spain. I mean, they
just... be fighting words there, Pedro.
Really?
Do you want to bring?
Yeah, he just said
Steven?
Thanks in my ear. All right.
All right, Pedro. Thank you very much for that. Still to come here on World One, tracking Hurricane Joba as it rolls into Mexico's west coast. We're live at the World Weather Center. Welcome back. This is World One, live from London. We want to check on those floods in Thailand and Hurricane Joba. Let's go to our meteorologist, Mari Ramos, at the World Weather Center. Mari.
Hi, what a mess really across some of these areas, particularly across Southeast Asia. We're about...
All right, Mari, thank you very much for that. Let's take a look at what's trending on social media right now. At number three, it's a story that started on CNN iReport, and it's getting a lot of shares. World's Way in Kathmandu is a showcase of culture in Nepal's capital, part of CNN's Destination Adventure series. iReporter Krista Gockel sent in this image saying, Durbar Square, shown here, is a meshing of old world and modern life. At number two, BlackBerry's blackout. Social media is buzzing with talk of the outage. Users in Europe and Africa and the Middle East have lost a number of services over the last few days, including the very popular messaging service. Some people online are pretty upset, but others have started a Twitter hashtag called Team BlackBerry, showing their support. And at number one, Google's tribute to Arthur Art Clokey. The latest doodle honors the stop-motion pioneer's 90th birthday. Clokey died in 2010 and was best known for creating Gumby, a clay figure that starred in The Gumby Show. The doodle features some of Clokey's characters popping out of balls of clay. This is World One, live from London. I'm Monita Rajpal. Thanks for joining us here on CNN.